The History of Clothing, Part 3. The rules of savoir-vivre in clothing changed over the centuries and reached their peak in the period around the turn of the 20th century. Today, we may find it funny to look back on how these rules affected almost all situations having to do with dress, and especially how very difficult it was in those days for women to find an appropriate outfit to wear while doing sports.
Trudny do rozwiązania problem odpowiedniego ubioru do uprawiania sportów. Pojawiły się rowery.
Then came the bicycle. Men rode on their bicycles in knickerbockers, but it was completely unheard of for women to wear trousers in public. Nevertheless, many women, after trying to ride in wide, pinned-up skirts, had to resign from this symbol of femininity. They dressed in very loose knickerbockers, which looked like skirts, even though it aroused a certain indignation among older women of a conservative mindset.
Pewne zgorszenie, zwłaszcza konserwatywniej nastawionych starszych pań. Podobnie rzecz się miała z kostiumem.
A similar situation arose with the bathing suit. We also forget, as we are used to today's extremely skimpy bikinis, topless outfits, and even nudist beaches, that the bathing suit, which appeared in the 1860s, wasn't used for bathing. It was only used for wading in the water. A woman would come out of the water and then in a covered cabin would change into a complete outfit. Corset, slip, dress, hat, gloves, boots, and only then would she parade around the beach. This early bathing suit wasn't even used for swimming, but for taking a dip in the water. There was too much material and too many decorations to even dog paddle a couple of meters.
Przepłynąć. I ta ewolucja bardzo powolna tego jakby oczyszczania się kostiumu kąpielowego.
It was a very slow evolution, ridding the bathing suit from its excessive decorations and improving the material itself, lasted all the way up to the Second World War. When we look at photographs, drawings, and pre-war films, we see that in the 1930s, beach outfits were quite hefty. At this point, the bathing suit had become more functional because it was made from wool tricot, which made it possible to swim. But even if braver women wore two-piece bathing suits for sunbathing, these too were quite solidly sewn bottoms and tops, and preferably worn with a throw or a draped skirt. It wasn't seemly to be amazed at the nicest tan or the woman with the nicest nude body. During the Second World War, due to the circumstances and due to the difficult living conditions in Poland, there was once again a reduction in the forms of clothing, along with the rules of how it was to be worn. There was no sense in expecting someone to wear an elegant black suit and tie on Christmas Eve after he had been forced out of his home in only a sweater and a pair of trousers. His possibilities were limited.
Bo po prostu takich możliwości nie było. Z kolei po II wojnie światowej.
In turn, after the Second World War, a new reality in Polish politics came into play, whereby one had to not only publicly, but also ostentatiously and with complete conviction, rebel against everything that had once been regarded as good manners and conventions.
Zakon wedanse, to jako przeżytek zgniłych burżuazyjnych czasów.
That which was a rotten leftover from bourgeoisie times was laughed at and eradicated. Actually, it was only thanks to the internal resistance of Polish society, as well as the opposition to official prohibitions, which was characteristic in those times, that certain forms of savoir vivre in clothing were observed and preserved.
Przestrzegane i przetrwały, nawet, prawda, obraz traktorzystki w...
Even a picture of a tractor driver in a green military uniform was a picture that tried to lure young people. But that same tractor driver would wear a billowy feminine dress to a dance party.
Nakładała jakąś bardziej kobiecą, powiewną sukienkę, a z kolei egalitaryzm przejawiał się chociażby...
Egalitarianism manifested itself in the fact that not only women from the city or from the higher social strata, but all women, beginning with the milkmaid on the collective farm and ending with the minister's secretary, could afford a permanent hair wave.
Mogły sobie panie pozwolić na wieczną, trwałą ondulację. Lata 60. przyniosły, jeśli chodzi o...
The 60s brought with them, when considering clothing worn in Poland, a general familiarity with fashion, because there was a significant difference between the former period. The Iron Curtain had been lifted a bit. Above all, Poland started receiving more films from the West, and our national magazines reproduced fashions which the great fashion designers were presenting.
Reprodukowanie modeli, które akurat wielcy krawcy paryscy proponowali, i ten dostęp do...
This access to the fashions of Western designers became easier, but by no means easy. Adopting a fashion which a French or English fashion designer had thought up was difficult to do, given the conditions in Poland.
Na polskie warunki było dość trudne. Brakowało materiałów, brakowało dodatków.
It was difficult to access materials and accessories. Fabrics were produced in tens of thousands of meters in the same pattern and color. Therefore, the danger of meeting not only a friend, but half the city in the same dress was quite real in those days.
Było jak najbardziej realne wówczas.
This larger access to fashion was linked with the progress of changing customs.
Oczywiście z postępującymi przemianami obyczajowymi.
When Mary Quant, during the mid-60s in London, proposed the mini as the fashionable skirt length, girls in Poland very quickly caught on to it, but had to overcome greater resistance of customs, because it was of a shocking length, unheard of until that point in women's fashion, especially when worn as everyday fashion.
W modzie właśnie tej przeznaczonej na co dzień, największe problemy miały oczywiście uczennice.
Schoolgirls, of course, had the most problems, for they wanted to keep up with the newest fashions. Unlike male teachers, who most probably liked this style, female teachers, concerned that their students appear modest, often sent home girls to put on a longer skirt or to put on a satin navy apron, which at the time was required during school hours as a rule. In the end, these aprons could ruin even the figure of a model.
Nakładały straszliwe, zupełnie granatowe, satynowe fartuchy, które nawet figurę modelki potrafiłyby zbrzydzić ostatecznie. I dalej już poszła.
Later it became a bit easier for Polish girls and boys who wanted to look more attractive for people by dressing in outfits designed in the West.
Bardziej przez polskie i dziewczęta, i chłopców wykorzystywana dążność do upodobnienia się do ludzi ubierających się w stroje projektowane na Zachodzie. Bardzo pomógł temu ruch hipisowski w latach 70.
The hippie movement of the 1970s helped in this. For that which we see from today's perspective, and which was also seen this way at the time, as a rebellion against conventions, appealed to leaders of communist Poland, because it was a rebellion against rotten capitalism. They were rebelling in the United States, in France, but in Poland, they couldn't even think about a real rebellion. What was important was what they emphasized their ties with the protesting teens of the West by wearing similar clothing. Then it became common to see billowing Indian-style dresses, long hair, and beads on Polish streets, not only in cities, but also in small towns and villages. What's more, it was a fashion attainable despite conditions in Poland. People would buy cloth diapers, dye them a nice color, and use them to sew billowy creations. It wasn't even expensive. The beaded necklaces favored by hippies were produced from beans or even paper mache. I suppose the most difficult era in the second half of the 20th century for Polish girls and boys, and generally for those who wanted to dress fashionably, was of course the 80s. State control, limits, rationed shoes, a lack of everything, and a lack of will to make an outfit dazzling. There was a lack of will to even show that one knew what was fashionable to wear, what was trendy in Paris, and what renowned designers were proposing. Because most people had difficult living conditions. Youth, on the other hand, was busy with something else. They were conspiring left and right. In my opinion, resistance was demonstrated in a beautiful and a moving way, because it was tied in with tradition. Little black crosses appeared and were mass-produced, as in the times of the January uprising. Electronic resistors, recognizable symbols for everyone, were worn in the jacket lapels. Of course, from today's point of view, as well as in those times, it is understood that the clothing of a real conspirer would allow the police to spot him a mile away, because he'd be wearing a dull brown sweater, baggy pants, a knapsack, hiking boots, and the resistor in his lapel. Everyone knew that you could be 99% sure that underground or conspiratorial literature was being carried in that knapsack. At the beginning of the Third Republic, in the late 80s and early 90s, there was a new political situation, yet a continuation of the difficult living conditions. But full freedom had arrived. You could choose to wear whatever you liked. You could look at foreign magazines. On television, you could watch the coverage of fashion shows in Paris. You could see what was happening in London, in New York. This excess, this freedom of choice that came to Polish society, was a little too rapid. Because although we say there are never too many good things, in this case, it proved to be that many people felt greatly disoriented. They didn't really know what was appropriate to wear to work, to the first communion of a child, to an examination, or on a trip. Somehow, the advice columns in women's magazines began to disappear because they were too strongly associated with the former years, when the magazines of the day gave good advice to their readers. This resulted in a few years of unskilled and not very well thought out attempts to keep up with fashion. To be fair, we must add that all the while the choice was there, but financial conditions of the majority of society proved that it was easier and more practical to buy a denim skirt laid out on a table on Marszałkowska Street or at the nearest bazaar, because it was simply cheap, instead of buying a brand name skirt at a proper store or in a department store.
Niż taką markową spódnicę kupić sobie no, w jakimś porządnym sklepie czy nawet domu towarowym.